Yesterday, I reported on the ban of the traditional Latin Mass at St. Peter's Basilica in the Vatican, a move that has critical symbolic importance in the life of the Church, and it is an obvious signal that the powers that be in the hierarchy are continuing to make moves against the traditional faith. Cardinal Burke issued a public letter on the suppression of the traditional Latin Mass, and you can describe it as blistering. I will have that for you here in a moment, but I wanted to bring you this bit of information first that Dr. Peter Kwasniewski pointed out on Twitter that has a connection to this act by the Vatican, and, well, to put it mildly, it's connected to the Pacamama incident in 2019, and I can't believe that I forgot about this. There are some relevant timely events that coincide with this move against the traditional Latin Mass. Quoting Dr. Peter Kwasniewski, 1. The Pacamama black ritual bowl with red flowers was placed on the altar over the tomb of St. Peter at the end of October 2019. 2. The Pope has not said Mass at the high altar in St. Peter's ever since then, a startling avoidance which, as far as I know, has no historical precedent. 3. The Pope presumably authorized the decree from the Secretariat of State to suppress private Masses at St. Peter's and send the TLM underground. 4. And in all in time for his 8th anniversary of accession on the Feast of St. Joseph during the year of St. Joseph and Amoris Laetitia. End quote. Now, an interesting thing is, it came out that the Pope actually had a Mass at St. Peter's this weekend for the first time since then. That's interesting also, although I don't know if it was at the high altar or not. But all of everything he said there is true. Also, I would add that this was done in the year that human fraternity is getting its biggest push by the Vatican. The Vatican letter suppressing the Mass said that this was being done in the name of liturgical decorum, whatever that means. And I can only take it to be a veiled reference to human fraternity through the liturgy, as the traditional movement in the Church is mistakenly associated with a mere liturgical preference. If your adherence to what you consider to be traditional Catholicism is purely a devotion to the traditional liturgy and it has no impact on how you live your life, then I'm going to just bluntly tell you that you are probably not a traditionalist. Now, while this all is a huge misunderstanding of traditional Catholicism, the push for human fraternity is at the heart of all we are seeing now, and even St. Joseph was used to push these ideas onto the faithful. Enough of that, though. On to Cardinal Burke and his statement on the suppression of the Mass. Statement on the offering of the Holy Mass in the Papal Basilica of St. Peter by Raymond Cardinal Burke. On March 12, 2021, the first section, General Affairs, of the Secretariat of State of Pope Francis issued a document containing certain dispositions regarding the offering of the Holy Mass in the Papal Basilica of St. Peter in the Vatican. The document is addressed to the Extraordinary Commissioner of the Fabric of St. Peter, the canonical institute responsible for the care of the Papal Basilica, to the canons of the Vatican Chapter, and to the service for liturgical celebrations of the Basilica. Both the form and content of the document rightly sustain the deepest concerns of the faithful and, above all, of priests. The concerns pertain not only to the Papal Basilica of St. Peter, but to the Universal Church, inasmuch as the Papal Basilica of St. Peter is, in a particular way, the spiritual home for all Catholics, and as such should be a model of liturgical discipline for the particular churches. Regarding the form of the document, there are several concerns. 1. It is an unsigned document from the first section of the Secretariat of State, without a protocol number, legislating regarding the most sacred aspect of the Church's life, the offering of the Holy Mass. It bears the seal of the first section with initials. While the document appears to be authentic, that is, not forged, it cannot be retained to be a document containing valid legislation for the sacred liturgy. 2. The Secretariat of State is not competent for the liturgical discipline of the Church, and, in particular, for the liturgical discipline at the Basilica of St. Peter in the Vatican. Rightly, one asks by what authority has the Secretariat of State issued directives which are contrary to the discipline of the Universal Church. A further question regards what process was followed to arrive at the publication of such an anomalous document. 3. given the incompetence of the Secretariat of State in the matter, the faithful have the right to know what competent authority gave the mandate to the Secretariat of State to legislate regarding the sacred liturgy, that is, to issue directives regarding the offering of the Holy Mass in the Papal Basilica of St. Peter. 4. The Papal Basilica of St. Peter in the Vatican now has a cardinal archpriest, but the document in question is not officially communicated to him. Neither is any reference made to his responsibility for the liturgical discipline at the basilica confided to his care. The content of the document is likewise a source of deepest concerns. 1. The document supposes that the Holy Mass in the Basilica of St. Peter are presently offered in a climate lacking, in some measure, in recollection and liturgical decorum. This is certainly not my experience. I know many priests, residents in Rome and visitors to Rome, who have celebrated or regularly celebrate the Holy Mass at St. Peter's Basilica. While they have expressed to me their profound gratitude for the opportunity to celebrate the Holy Mass in the Basilica, they have not indicated that the climate in which they have celebrated the Holy Mass in the Basilica was in any way lacking in the reverence, recollection, and dignity which benefits the sacrament of sacraments. 2. The document imposes concelebration upon priests who wish to offer the Holy Mass in St. Peter's Basilica, which is contrary to universal church law, and which unjustly conditions the primary duty of the individual priest to offer the Holy Mass daily for the salvation of the world. See Canon 902. In what church more than in the Basilica of St. Peter would a priest desire to offer the Holy Mass, which is the most perfect and fullest way in which he carries out his priestly mission? If an individual priest wishes to offer the Holy Mass in the Basilica, once the directives in question are in force, he will be constrained to concelebrate, in violation of his freedom to offer the Holy Mass individually. 3. Regarding the individual offering of the Holy Mass, it must be observed that it is not only a question of a rite of the priest, but also of great spiritual fruit for the whole church, since the infinite merits of the holy sacrifice of the Mass are more greatly and widely applied in a matter befitting our finite and temporal nature. It is helpful to reflect upon the teaching of the Council of Trent regarding the situation of a priest who offers the Holy Mass without any member of the faithful receiving Holy Communion. Regarding the participation of the faithful at the Holy Mass, the Council teaches, quote, "The Holy Council would certainly like the faithful present at every Mass to communicate in it, not only by spiritual devotion, but also by sacramental reception of the Eucharist, so that the fruits of this most holy sacrifice could be theirs more fully." It goes on to state, quote, "But if this does not always happen, the Council does not know, for that reason, condemn as private and illicit. Masses, Canon 8, in which only the priest communicates. Rather, it approves and commends them, for they too should be considered truly communal masses, partly because the people communicate spiritually in them, and partly because they are celebrated by a public minister of the church, not for his own good alone, but for all the faithful who belong to the body of Christ." See Session 22, Chapter 6 of the Council of Trent. It should be further observed that a priest never offers the Holy Mass alone, even if there is no one else physically present, for the angels and saints assist at every offering of the Holy Mass. See Canon 903. 4. With regard to the extraordinary form of the Roman Rite, which the document falsely calls the extraordinary rite, the document refers to quote-unquote authorized priests, but no priest in good standing needs authorization to offer the Holy Mass according to the extraordinary form of the Roman Rite. See Motu Proprio Summorum Pontificum, Article 2. What is more, the document limits the offering of the Holy Mass according to the extraordinary form, or usus antiquor, of the Roman Rite in the Papal Basilica of St. Peter to the Clementine Chapel at 4 fixed times. Is it supposed, therefore, that each day only 4 priests will be permitted to offer the Holy Mass according to the usus antiquor in the Papal Basilica of St. Peter? Since universal church law permits the individual priest in such circumstances to offer the Holy Mass according to either the ordinary form or the extraordinary form, the directive in question is in direct violation of universal church law. 5. The document also legislates that the concelebrated masses be animated liturgically by the service of lectors and cantors, while the liturgical discipline of the Church provides for the service of lectors and cantors. It is not their purpose to animate the sacred liturgy. Christ alone, in whose person the priest acts, animates the sacred liturgy. Therefore, it should not be thought that the individual offering of the Holy Mass is somehow less animated, in the true spiritual sense, than the concelebrated Mass. 6. For the sake of the Catholic faith and for the good order of the sacred liturgy, the highest and most perfect expression of the Church's life in Christ, the document in question should be rescinded immediately, that is, before its supposed effective date of March 22nd next. Furthermore, the thinking which underlies such a document should be corrected, while the discipline of the universal Church and the liturgical doctrine by which underlies it is expounded for the faithful. In conclusion, Church discipline recognizes the right, and indeed the duty, of the Christian faithful to make known to their pastors their concerns regarding matters which pertain to the good of the Church, and likewise to make such concerns known to all Christian faithful. See Canon 212, subsection 3. Given the gravity of the situation represented by the document in question, it is my hope that many of the Christian faithful, for whom the Basilica of St. Peter is in a particular sense their mother church, and above all, many priests from throughout the world, will make known to Pope Francis and to his Secretariat of State their strong objection to the document in question. Signed, Raymond Leo Cardinal Burke, in Rome on the 13th of March, 2021. So, Cardinal Burke is saying this letter is utterly illegitimate, that the act was not in keeping with the canons of the Church. Again, I said this is blistering, and in the way that Cardinal Burke speaks, this is extremely blistering. But let me know your thoughts on this in the comments, please. I'm quite happy, personally, to see that Cardinal Burke has broken his generally long silence on most things going on in the Church. And it doesn't surprise me that it took this move against the traditional liturgy and the implications it has for the traditional faith in general to get him to break his silence. But let me know your thoughts. Those are mine. If you like videos like this, please like, comment, and subscribe. It helps a lot. And as always, please pray for the Church, especially in these times. Thanks for listening. I'm Anthony Stein. Ave Maria.